The Audio-Technica AT2040 is the first microphone ever to disappoint me. In fact, I can see that this is a microphone that people love to hate. But when I spent 3 full days with this mic, I decided to scrap 4 hours' worth of footage of me just dismissing this mic. And that's because I discovered two easy hacks to optimize this microphone. Now, will those hacks redeem the Audio-Technica AT2040? Let's find out. Going straight to the point, would I recommend this mic? For budget-conscious content creators who want a balance of striking aesthetic appeal and utilitarian sound, then I would say yes. But if you want a pleasing, velvety sound, then this mic might not make the cut for you. I'll explain what utilitarian sound means later in this video. Box inclusions. That's a pretty nice-looking box, very Audio-Technica. It comes with a nice leather pouch, and look just how expensive looking that is. I wonder if you can fit a tiny person inside. Is anyone alive out there? Can anyone hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you! I'm trying to sleep here!
It's got a 5/8-inch to 3/8-inch thread adapter, so you can immediately attach it to tabletop stands like this. And so you can attach it to mic arms like this one. And paper. Now for build quality, this thing is built like a tank. How do I know? It looks the part. That, and because it fell from this height because I attached it to a cheap boom arm that couldn't carry its weight, so it's probably because I've got a carpeted floor. Still impressive because it doesn't have a single scratch or dent. Now let's do a few mic comparisons. You're now hearing me talk into the Shure SM7B. You're now hearing me talk into the Audio-Technica AT2040. You're now hearing me talk into the Shure SM58. You're now hearing me talk into the Audio-Technica AT2040. These are the microphone's main selling points. Selling point number one, it has a built-in high-pass filter. Because it has a frequency response of 100 Hz to 16 kHz, it practically has a high-pass filter that's always on. A high-pass filter lets the highs pass through and the lows not pass through. It essentially gets rid of unwanted bass frequencies like stomping on the floor and other low reverberations. The Shure SM7B also has a high pass filter in the form of a switch. Can see it right here. And it has been activated. And here's how that would look at the back of your Shure SM7B. My concern with the Shure SM7B's high-pass filter is that it begins rolling off at 300 Hz, which includes a lot of your core vocal frequencies, so you're left with your voice being irredeemably thin. Some people might like the sound. Personally, this is not the sound that I would think of when getting an SM7B. Now the AT2040 only eliminates bass below 100 Hz, which is perfect for most people, unless you've got a deep trailer voice, which I obviously don't have. And having that high pass filter on at all times means you'll save one step in your recording workflow. And for live applications like streaming, calls, and webinars, it's like you have this bass noise cancellation that's always on without using software. Selling point number two, it has an internal shock mount. By the way, the SM7B and SM58 also have internal shock mounts, so it's not very novel. Shock mounts help the microphone reject unwanted vibrations like tapping on my desk and tapping my foot, which I'm gonna do now. Now tapping on my desk. Tapping my foot. I am talking while typing, talking while typing. I am just button mashing. I'm not sure what I'm actually typing right now. Now I'm gonna replace the mount that comes with the mic with an actual external shock mount. And this is the one that comes with the Audio-Technica AT2020. Now let's go through those same tests with the shock mount. Now tapping on my desk. Tapping, tapping. Now tapping my foot. I'm talking while typing. Talking while typing. Using this external shock mount. It gives me superpowers while I play this MOBA that does not exist. Now let's test the internal shock mount on the Shure SM58. Talking while typing. Tapping on my desk. Tapping on my desk. Tapping on the floor. Tapping on the floor. Selling point number three, it has a built-in pop filter. It's supposed to have one of these inside of this. These basically help you prevent getting these poppy noises. Pop, pop, pop. And the SM58 has one too, so it's still not very novel. But for the SM58, it's essentially a foam ball, as you can see in there. And you can see the light passing through, so you know your sound also passes through. You can actually look at the pop filter in the AT2040 by twisting the grill like so. And knowing their build quality, this is going to be totally fine. And there you go. This is what it looks like on the inside. They call this their multi-stage foam mesh windscreen with a non-woven filter. Wow, that is a mouthful. It looks kind of similar to the pop filter that Podcastage uses, which does not introduce any coloration to the sound. So I'm hoping it behaves the same way. For the plosive test, we'll do that in hack number two. Selling point number four, it has a hypercardioid puller pattern. Most broadcast dynamic mics are cardioid only without the hyper. What this means is that the 80-20-40 would capture more of what's in front and less of what's on the side. But the drawback is that it will capture a little bit of sound from the back as well. Tapping the front, tapping the middle, now tapping the back as well. I'm actually talking from behind the mic just in case that really is picked up. So let's speak into the mic while rotating it. I love creating microphone reviews. 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 In comparison, the AT2020 is cardioid only, so let's put that to the test. I love creating microphone reviews. 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 Selling point number five, it's a dynamic mic, which means it picks up less reverb in the room and other external noises. Here's how quiet your background noise can get with a conversational speaking volume. Now with the AT2040 directly pointing at my split type AC. I'm now speaking into the Audio-Technica AT2040 in an untreated room at a distance of about 2 fingers, so maybe 3 fingers. Let's do 5 fingers. Now let's do 10 fingers away from the microphone. And this is how the Audio-Technica AT2040 sounds in an untreated room with the fan on. The fan is pointing directly at me, and I can be comfortable here for hours with this temperature. How does it sound? 3 inches away from the mic, 3 fingers away from the mic, 5 fingers away, 10 fingers away from the microphone. Maybe I should get a ruler. Now let's do a background noise test with the AT2020, a condenser mic. Now with the AC directly behind me. Selling point number six, it's a budget mic. For about $100 US, you get raw audio quality that's completely usable for a podcast. A bit of compression and EQing would be nice though. If you're looking at the Audio-Technica AT2040, which is a budget mic, then you're probably also looking at a budget interface like the Behringer UM2. Yeah, and this is how it sounds on the Behringer UM2. You're now hearing the AT2040 on the Behringer UM2. Selling point number seven. The mic looks good. Now on to the mic hacks. Hack number one. Get close. Other content creators I've seen using this mic tend to use it from afar. Maybe this distance or this distance. And you can hear that it doesn't have a lot of presence and it kind of sounds muffled. But the moment that you get closer to that microphone, you begin to introduce more proximity effect, which introduces more bass. What's interesting about this is, based on what I'm hearing, this is actually introducing additional clarity to the audio by introducing more highs. Now, I could be wrong, but it's possible that by getting up close, we're allowing the highs to pass through the pop filter much easier. Now, if you're really kissing the mic, you introduce more muddiness, and if you add the clarity from earlier, the overall combination isn't the best for intelligibility. To exaggerate a point, I'm going to get rid of the cover so I can get much closer to the diaphragm. Much, much, much closer, like so. Yeah, I wouldn't use that. I'm finding that a 1 or 2 finger distance between the mic's grill and my lips is optimal for my voice. Hack number two, remove the pop filter. Now, why would I want to do that? In my testing, it makes the AT2040 sound noticeably more articulate. With a pop filter inside, the microphone kind of sounds like it's got a blanket over it, so I figured I'd remove the blanket. I'm speaking into the AT2040 with the pop filter inside. Okay, let's get rid of that. I'm speaking into the AT2040 with a pop filter removed.
For comparison, you're hearing me talk into the Shure SM7B with the foam windscreen on. You're now hearing me talk into the Shure SM7B without the foam windscreen on. And this kind of setup without the foam windscreen on the Shure SM7B is pretty common among musicians, apparently. Many of them would get rid of this and put a pop filter in front instead.
Back with the pop filter inside, now you must be concerned about the plosives, so let's do some plosive tests. Bad mic placement with a pop filter inside. Peter Piper picked a pack of pickled peppers. Bad mic placement with a pop filter removed. Peter Piper picked a pack of pickled peppers. Now a plosive test with a pop filter inside with good mic placement. Peter Piper picked a pack of pickled peppers. Now this is a plosive test without the pop filter inside with good mic placement. Peter Piper picked a pack of pickled peppers. Let's talk about the pros and cons. 1. It looks good, and that matters because it impacts psychoacoustics. Unless you do a completely blind test, your perception of sound tends to be influenced by what you know about the source. If you know the microphone's brand, appearance, and price point, that can cause you to imagine that the microphone sounds better. I've used this mic for a business live stream, and people were immediately impressed by the sound. The microphone is actually pretty sizable compared to something like the SM7B. For a dynamic, it isn't a gain-hungry mic. Given that the Behringer UM2, the budget king of audio interfaces, can power the Audio-Technica AT2040 to a respectable level without introducing a lot of hiss, I don't think you'll be needing one of these or a cloud lifter. 3. This mic doesn't capture a lot of reverb by virtue of being a dynamic mic, which essentially means you get near prosumer level audio without the need for a studio. A bit of acoustic treatment will help, of course, but you won't need as much as a condenser would. The ultimate pro of this mic is that its entire feature set, from the fact that it's dynamic, hypercardioid, has a built-in pop filter and shock mount, allow it to have an incredible signal-to-noise ratio. That is still, of course, affected by other factors like your audio interface, your room treatment, the noise in your area, but in general, this package gets you really close to pro sound with a minimal budget. A good signal-to-noise ratio basically means having much more of your voice and far less of any kind of noise in your recording. And again, this mic looks good. Let's talk about the cons. The sound changes dramatically from your mouth's distance to the tip of the mic, so you have to practice having a consistent mic placement. Con 2, since the frequency response ends at 16 kilohertz, it doesn't sound as detailed as I'd like it to be. And add the pop filter, yeah, it really doesn't sound very detailed. Con 3, it's not the warmest sounding microphone. The highs are brittle sounding, and the similarly priced SM58 just sounds more pleasant. Con 4, if you're just getting started with improving your audio, you will need an XLR cable and an audio interface. Now for the voice actors out there, let's do some voiceover tests. Commercial. Introducing the biggest thing in coffee since coffee. More coffee. New shot-in-the-dark coffee from Dunkin'. Narration. Water. Earth. Fire. Air. Long ago, the four nations lived together in harmony. Then, everything changed when the Fire Nation attacked.
Character. No, you're wrong. My friends need me. And I need them. Together, we make the best team in the world!
Bringing it home. If you're a budget-minded content creator, and you're trying to strike that balance between good sound and good looks, then this could be the mic for you. If you're a new voice actor looking to book your first professional gigs, with this you might be able to book some local to regional level projects with smaller companies. And get a lot of indie work. This could help you jumpstart your career if you're having challenges with your recording space. For voice actors in general, this would be a great backup mic in a pinch, just in case your condenser captures way too much of the heavy rain, babies crying, and dogs barking. If you're looking for a high-end sound with lots of warmth and clarity, this is not the mic for that. If you like this mic review, check out this other one I made.